Welcome to In the Venn Zone with Christine McKay, where we get candid about what it takes to negotiate effectively. You'll learn from the challenges and successes of entrepreneurs, executives, and experts. We help you change the nature of your negotiations and get more from every deal you do.
Welcome back, everyone, to another exciting episode of In the Venn Zone, where we help you, the small business owner, elevate your negotiation and level the playing field in all that you negotiate. And we do that by bringing amazing guests to you who are also business owners, as well as people who talk about psychology of negotiating. We bring to you CEOs of major corporations to tell you as how to be more effective in your negotiation with them. But today I am really excited to have, and as I'm always excited about my guests because I just like, I'm very picky about who I like to bring on the show. So I am really excited to have with me today, Brenda Sterling Myers. Brenda is the founder and CEO of Sterling Tea. And as many of you know, I am a diehard tea drinker. So I've been making tea, loose leaf tea, every morning for the past 25 years from the same Japanese cast iron pot that my dear friend Barry Dunsmore gave me many, many years ago. And so tea is a fascinating, fascinating business. And Gary Vaynerchuk actually once said that if somebody can figure out how to do what he did for wine on the internet, but with tea, they're going to make a killing. And because tea is just wonderfully complex, there's just so many different varieties, etc. But the business of tea is a fascinating business because it's agriculture on one level, but it's, you know, just this, it's, you know, what, you've got the wholesale component and the retail component. And so I wanted to bring with you to you this morning, Brenda, so we could sit and talk about the tea business and how she has negotiated throughout her time in the business. So Brenda, tell us, welcome. First, welcome. Thank you so much for taking time out of your day to spend with us. We really appreciate it.
Sure.
So tell us a little bit about where you're at and how you got here. How did you decide to launch a tea business?
Well, it started 15 years ago in my kitchen. And my children were little and I loved tea, but it wasn't, it was something I drank, something I enjoyed, something I had always loved since I was a child. But I never thought of it as a business until one day I did. And I was helping somebody plan an event. It was a bridal shower. And I was like, oh, let's do a tea party. So I went online and I was looking up, you know, how to have a tea party. And I'm looking at it, I'm like, oh my goodness, there's business. This is a business. And I had always kind of dabbled in making some blends, just a couple blends that I liked. And I thought, well, let me make some blends and see what I can do. So it just so happened, I had some friends and I was helping put together this little Christmas event. And so I took my teas to the Christmas event and I set up a booth and I had six teas and I printed my own labels and, you know, set them out and poured people tea and showcased them in a little tin, like I still do now, so that they can see how pretty the leaves were. And I'm in a small town in Texas. It's not so small, but 15 years ago, it was a small town. Mm-hmm. And people looked at it and they're like, what is this? Like, they had no clue. If it wasn't Lipton or sweet tea, you know, right? I'm in Texas. They had no idea. In fact, they looked at my white tea, which is real leafy and it has buds. Right. And I think someone asked me, you know, is that like marijuana? You know, what is that? And so I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't believe that nobody knows about the beauty and luxury and wonderfulness of loose leaf tea. Mm. I need to teach everybody. So I thought about it for a long time and I decided, you know, I'm going to see if I can start a little tea business, you know, just for fun, just for my community. So Sterling Tea was born in October of 2005. And from there, I opened up a tea shop. I had bought a little old 1916 house and I put a tea shop in there. And so I just started creating blends with the customers that would come in. And when I first opened, like nobody came. And then I started going and like speaking at little free events and doing more of those little like farmers markets. And pretty soon I started getting a little following of people just like you who mm-hmm. love tea or they wanted to learn more. So I started to have tea 101 courses in my shop and tea tasting classes. And I just got really into the education of it. Mm. And then I started making more blends and people would test them. And then this would be at my blend. And then a restaurant approached me locally that was opening up and said, would you make us an iced tea? And so I made them a black currant. And from there, I started getting the bug. Well, if I'm really going to grow, I need businesses to sell tea. So from there, I started making tea for restaurants. I started doing blending for other tea companies, coffee shops. I got distribution. Went through the whole grocery thing for a while. And now today we have, you know, hundreds of customers and we make tea for businesses who serve and sell their brand with, you know, we make their tea. So we really partner with them. We make their tea for them. We white label it and then they serve it and sell it to their guests under their own name. So that I love doing that. So
that's awesome. That's, so when I meet people, one of the things that I like to do is send people a note card with forget-me-not seeds. Maybe I do tea packets. Maybe I do something with tea because, I mean, both of them are like very, very Christine. And that's awesome. So one of the things that before we got on that, so you actually just went through a lot of things. And I'm kind of going back to the conversation that we were having before we started recording. And that was I said, well, we want to talk about kind of the things that you negotiate. And your response was, well, I don't really negotiate. And I get a lot of this from small businesses. But then you just talked about how you do blending, you sell to businesses, you were in stores, you have distribution. Sounds to me like there might be a fair amount of negotiation in all that. Tell us about some of the things that you like. So you were in stores. Mm-hmm. So tell us a little bit about that because we're headquartered in California and California has a cottage industry law on the books. And what that allows people to do is to create, you know, food-based businesses out of their home with less regulation and then be able to sell it into stores and restaurants with the different labeling requirements than you'd have if you are a larger organization. So tell us about how did you decide what stores to go into? What was kind of that process? What was important to you as you were thinking about that? And what made you change? What made you change directions?
Change direction?
Or are you still in store? Are you still in stores? Or
grocery stores? Yeah. I still am, but it's not my focus, and it's not. I don't enjoy it as much, honestly. So here's what I did. When I didn't stay in my kitchen for very long. Because I opened up the tea shop and immediately I went and got a manufacturing. Well, first you get your food service license from the city so that you can do things like sell to customers, like retail customers, people that are going to drink the tea. And then when I started doing the business, I'm a rule follower. So I right away got the Department of Health manufacturing license, the FDA. I did all the things I needed to do. So I was doing it right. But I never did the cottage part. We can do that here in Texas, but I never went that route. I went from kitchen very, very quickly to, you know, where I needed to mm-hmm. make it so it's legitimate and so I can follow the rules. So when I first started going into businesses, aside from the local restaurants like the tea shop and the pizza place and some of the places that came to me, I knew that it was going to be difficult. So I very briefly... And I did not like doing this, but just to get my confidence, I would go in and do like a share, like percentage share. Like I'll put this on your shelf. And if it sells, we'll do a 70-30 split or, you know what those are. I don't know. I forget what you call it.
Revenue share.
Yeah. It was a share where they didn't have to pay for the product until it was sold. Right. Well, that doesn't really work well with food. So I decided really quickly, I don't want to do that anymore. So I think I did it with one or two stores and I'm like, no. So then I got a showroom at the Dallas World Trade Center and at the Atlanta Gift Mart. Mm-hmm. And that really helped me get into stores. So I did that for years. I mean, I think I had a showroom at the Dallas Trade Center, the World Trade Center. And you know what that is? That's where businesses come and they supply their stores.
Sure. Yep.
So I had a showroom there until probably 2017. Mm-hmm. And in Atlanta until about 2012. So I kicked off my business doing it that way. And I learned a lot from other small business owners just like me, how to sell to these stores. And, you know, I made a lot of friends in my industry, mm-hmm. and not just tea, but all types of foods, and figured it out, you know. And I thank goodness for the people that I met, because they helped me so much learn and understand. And, you know, because I did not have a blueprint when I started. So I just kind of winged it and said, okay, I'm going to do this. And I'm watching these people do this. And I think I can do that too. And so that's how it started with me. As far as getting into grocery stores, I'm in Whole Foods and Central Market. And that was really them reaching out to me, because they wanted to work locally, and they wanted that, to be able to tout local, you know?
Right.
But I found my niche. And today, what I do now is my favorite thing. And that's creating the blends and helping other companies achieve success, serving and selling their brand to their customers. Because let's face it, everybody likes their own name. Like, look behind you, you know, name on it. You know, Sterling Tea is great in Texas, but when we get outside of Texas, it's kind of like, can I put my name on it? I'm like, go ahead. I don't care. I just want to sell tea. So that partnership has created these relationships with my customers that I just love. And I love to hear their successes and to know that my piece of their business, like my little piece of making their teas for them, has brought more customers and more raving fans into their stores. And then I love to hear, you know, oh, they love that tea. And I'm like, good, let's do more of that, you know? So
that was something that we kind of started talking about a little bit, because in kind of the, when we talk about negotiation styles, you are a modern benefactor. And so that desire to have relationship is a very natural thing for you. Mm-hmm. And you were talking about how when you find somebody that you connect with, that you like to work with, you will stay with them. You're not the person who switches suppliers and kind of jumps ships based on price. You stick with somebody and you develop a deeper loyal relationship. Has that ever, and do you have any examples of when that hasn't worked for you, when something went wrong in a relationship like that and you had to make a change? Or has all the relationships that you've been able to build over the years kind of worked out the way that you had hoped?
Unfortunately, yes. I mean, if you do anything long enough, there's going to be good and bad. I'd love to talk more about the good ones, but I will mention one off the top of my head. It was a company that was based out of Germany. Mm-hmm. And I was working with this person. It was his company, but I look at the person who I'm dealing with. He was the president. And we worked together very well. And then one time, a product was sent to us that had bugs in it. And this happens sometimes because I buy a lot of organic product. Mm-hmm. And so what will happen is they'll ship the product over and there might be some eggs in there. It only takes a couple eggs to just, you know.
Yep.
It makes me sick. I mean,
I can't even imagine.
Chamomile, lemon balm, you know, there are just certain products that when they come in, it's like, so I have this huge freezer now that all my stuff goes in, and it's just, you know, it's nobody's fault. And of course, nobody wants to take the blame. So what usually happens is I get stuck. So I have this relationship with this company where they, you know, brought this stuff over from Germany, and it had, right away, I mean, we looked at the bag. It's like, oh my gosh, get that out of the warehouse, you know? So I called my vendor who I'd been working with for years and explained it to him. He said, I will take care of it. Ship it all back to me. So the whole shipping issue, it just became a problem. And it went from, I will take care of you, I will make this right, to, I don't know, maybe he lost money on the deal or something happened. And it was just a real negative transaction. And when it was all said and done, we just couldn't work together anymore. And it's so unfortunate because I really liked him, but he didn't do what he said. He didn't take care of it. And so we just parted ways. I just moved on, you know, and it was after years of working. And so that was really sad. And I still feel bad about that whole thing. I had another issue where I bought some stuff out of Egypt and the stuff came and it was completely infested. It never even made it into the warehouse. I made the shipping company take it away. And they claimed no responsibility and the shipping company claimed no responsibility. So of course I had to pay the shipping. I had already paid for half the product. And my only option with them was, I can't work with you ever again. And that was my first time working with them. So I didn't have a relationship. I trusted. So those two incidents make me ask questions, even before, like, exactly how do you look at your product? How do you know there's no bugs? How do you, what procedures do you put into place? Mm. And these are not things that I understood, because when I started purchasing, I was purchasing small quantities through several hands. But when you go directly from the plantation to your warehouse, there are some things you definitely need to know that nobody tells you until bad things happen.
So that kind of goes to what we talked about earlier in terms of what you actually do negotiate. So as many of the listeners know, my view is price generally, not 100% of the time, but generally price should be an output of your negotiation, because it's the assumptions that go into your relationship that actually get you to price. So what you're just describing is absolutely just that. Things that transpire in, you know, from going from plantation to, and if you've never been to a tea plantation, I got to go to one in Indonesia on the island of Java. Mm-hmm. It's pretty darn cool to go to a tea plantation. But what happens from, you know, the time that it leaves the plantation to the time of shipping, and when you have, this is an agricultural product, so you can have bugs and, you know, all sorts of other things that happen. If you buy hard products, you can have defects that are in the production. You can have in-field failure rates in terms of how things get installed. And so that's actually a huge thing. What happens in shipping when you get something that's defective? And who owns that? Who owns that cost? How much, you know, and how much product are you willing to accept before you start penalizing your supplier, mm-hmm. right? So if you have, you know, 3 shipments or 10 shipments and 10% of it's defective, then you should be negotiating in your contracts to have compensation come back to you as a result of that high defect rate.
Right.
How have you been able to apply them to other relationships? Because I think that's very valuable and it's not something we've actually had a chance to talk about on the show before. So,
okay. So so at this point, and I mentioned this to you off the air, I have my choice now to take my money elsewhere, right? Mm. And I know which products I have to really watch versus because of time, because of 15 years of doing this, I know what to look for. We have our own systems in place now at our warehouse that, you know, I had to learn and what to look for and the questions to ask before I even make the purchase. And with the full knowledge that I won't do business with somebody that won't stand behind their product. Mm. And there are enough people out there that want my business. I mean, I get an email every day from someone in China, you know, from LinkedIn, especially constantly, but I stick with my guy. So I want to do a positive one because I have a gentleman I work with in China. His name is David. I was just talking to him this morning, texting with him this morning. And what I love about him is he appreciates our relationship and he's so good at communicating with me about everything that's going on, from what's happening over in China right now, country-wise with COVID and all that, mm-hmm. to, you know, just the shipping rates and the dollar, and just really keeps me, I can tell he appreciates working with me and mm-hmm. I with him. And so we've been working together for years, and I met him at a trade show and he was in a line of probably 30 other companies from China. And when I walked down each of them and talked to each of these, because I was trying to decide where I wanted to, you know, import from, he stood out in my conversation with him and we bonded. And so you are right. To me, relationship is extremely important because I have to be able to trust when I have something coming over from another country that they will stand behind it. And he has. And it's, unfortunately, we haven't had this problem too often. We have way, way more success than issues, which I'm so happy about. So I would say that that's putting systems in place and asking, you know, how do you handle your materials organic? How do you keep from, you know, infestations? And I'm doing the same thing in Canada. I'm working with a company in Canada that flies their product in from Egypt because I didn't want to go direct from Egypt anymore. I just didn't feel comfortable. So we have a middle ground of a company that we use now out of Canada, Egypt to Canada, Canada to me. And so I'm able to really let him know this is the experience I had and this cannot happen. So with him, I don't pay until 30 days that I'm completely happy with the product. And it works out because what I do, I get the product in, we let it, we watch it for 10 days, 5 days. I mean, he gets paid way before 30 days. So I make sure that when I am happy that they get their money right away. And here you go. Thank you so much. And I think that that creates now the next time we order together, like we're working together on a new deal right now. And he's just happy to, you know, he knows I'm going to take care of him. I pay it. I pay fast. I pay on time. And I don't mess with people when it comes to money. It's like, you give me a good product, you're going to, you know, you're going to get paid for it. But I don't do the 100% upfront stuff anymore. I just don't, unless it's with a credit card, you know?
This reminds, so there's another interview that in the episode. So if you haven't listened to the interview with Mark McShirley, who is the co-founder of a company called Roof Simple, he talks about, so you just talked about something that he also talked about that I think is really important, because as small business owners, we sometimes get tied up in the contract, right? So we've got a contract that's got delivery terms and payment terms and all these things. And in Mark's case, it was a different situation. And he essentially, they got overextended in their business and they owed their supplier of roofing materials almost $800,000 and couldn't pay it. And so he was able to secure a loan from his supplier. But what he did is the contract, the repayment contract was over a certain period of time and he had to pay once a month. But what he did is every single week, he sent them money and a detailed explanation of where the business was at. And that's what you're talking about too. It's like, this is, you know, we have this arrangement. My deal with them, my contract, informal or formal, is net 30. But if I get the product and it passes my, quality assurance test, then I'm going to pay them as soon as it passes the quality assurance test.
Yeah.
Right. And I think, and that, I mean, for both of you and Mark, that goes to when he realized that he couldn't pay in the time that he'd originally agreed, they're like, that's fine. You know, we can extend the time because he'd done such a great job of building such a great relationship. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and just like you with this, with, you know, with your supplier in Canada, you've done such a great job of building that relationship because you're not holding out and just living by the contract and recognizing where they are at as well, because 30 days is a long time for any small business.
Right.
It's just a long time.
Well, and I don't know why bigger companies get away with that. Like, you know, there's a big box company out there that I understand sometimes doesn't pay for, you know, hundreds of days.
180 days is very common for in the consumer packaged goods world and in the big box retail space.
And I don't work with people like that. I just don't. I don't even want to. I mean, and I know some people say, well, you should take those big contracts. I'm like, I don't want to. I don't want that. I'm so happy that I get to choose who I work with. Mm. And I don't choose to work with these big box companies and just throw my product in there and then pray that I'll get paid and use all my money up over here so I can't help the people that are helping, that are paying me on time or up front. Mm-hmm. And because I'm a small business and I'm working with companies like my China connection and my India connection, they both work with humongous companies, like way bigger than me. And that's part of the reason I took them on too, is because I'm like, you know, I feel confident that if XYZ is buying from you, then, you know, I feel good, like you've got good product. Mm-hmm. So now it's just the relationship. Right. So what will make them want to work with someone little with me by, you know, with me being little smaller versus just saying, you know what, I'm just going to work with the big guys at the end. Well, what do I do differently? I pay quick, you know, right. And I have the potential for growth. So they can. So a smart guy, smart business owner is going to say, I'm going to work with them. They're paying me timely. They're nice. They're easy to get along with. And they could possibly get really big. And so they're banking on that. And I make them feel that way because I kind of tell them what we're doing and where we're going. And yes, my orders get a little bigger and bigger, but my orders get bigger with them because I trust them more.
Right.
Not necessarily because I started small. And so I kind of plan that. So they see growth with Sterling Tea and they see that we've got this partnership and I pay them on time without right. any issue. So, I mean, if you're smart, you work with me because I'll do that with you, you know?
Well, what you just did is you described actually classic negotiation. You said, okay, so in thinking about, I did a presentation last week and the woman who was hosting the event walked away and she goes, oh my gosh, I learned one really important thing. I learned that I need to think about my counterpart. And for me, I was just like, well, yes. But for you, because relationship is such a critical component to how you develop how you've grown your business, it's a very natural thing for you to think about relationship. It's not natural for everybody to think the way that you do, but you just walked through very classic negotiation. My counterpart has, this is their business. This is what their business looks like. A huge percentage of their business is coming from big companies. Big companies behave in this way when they buy tea. They take a long time to pay. They're probably more demanding. They incur additional costs because they demand faster shipping. They want they probably siphon off a huge percentage of the product at a certain level before other people get it. And they've got all these different things that they go through. So then you sit and say, "Well, I can't compete with that, right? So how do I carve out a space for myself that makes me relevant and important to my supplier?"
Right.
And this is, and I do a lot of David and Goliath negotiation is what I call it. And so I work with a lot of small businesses who are negotiating with large companies as either suppliers or with customers. And this is a really important point. As a small business owner, you have to figure out what's important to your counterpart so that you can make that space for yourself, make yourself different, make yourself stand up so that that customer or that supplier wants to work with you.
Right.
And so you did that in a very natural way. So you pay faster because big companies take forever. But the other thing is that you also are very clear, and we talk a lot when we're in our programs and stuff around the importance of getting clarity on what it is that you want. And you're very clear on, I do not want to work in this type of situation. I do not want to work with this type of client. And did you have a process that you went through to get to that level of clarity? And I know, I mean, it took 15 years. It took a long time to get there. But what are some of the lessons that you learned or things that you did along the way to get that kind of clarity? Because you are very clear on who your customer is.
Well, you know, when you get knocked down and you say, that happened and that's never going to happen again. And that's what happened to me. So I got taken advantage of early on with a grocery store. And that's what left a bad taste in my mouth about grocery stores. Very taken advantage of. I'm not going to get into it any more than taught me a very valuable lesson of taking my time and investing it in X and not doing Y. And then when things didn't, when I started realizing what was happening, I'm like, uh-oh, I put all my eggs in this basket. I shouldn't have done that. Mm. So I now do two things differently. I don't want anybody to have, you know, 50% of my time for, in my business. Mm-hmm. And then I'm at this point, I'm choosing, I mean, talking about customers now, mm-hmm. choosing the type of customers I like to work with the most. And mm-hmm. it's real easy for me. It's like, are you into it? You know, do you like tea? I mean, I have some customers who get into tea simply because it's the hot thing right now and they don't even like tea. I was like, what are you doing? You don't even know anything about it. So, which is why I'm starting a tea training program for that reason, because there are businesses that want to get into tea. They just don't understand it like you do. You know, most people don't. So, I just, you know, you get burned by certain types of companies, or you've watched friends get burned. I mean, I've had friends in this industry. I told you I made a lot of friends when I was at those different shows. And I saw people get wiped out by the big box companies. I saw it. And I'm like, oh, that's not going to happen to me. I'm not doing that. So I think that's where it comes from. Maybe a little fear, or maybe just let me just do what I like to do, what I know, and I'll build my business that way. It might take a little longer, which it did, but I got time, you know, and I get to enjoy my customers that I'd like to work with. And they're people that are into their product, that love their customers, and that treat my employees nicely. That's very important to me, because if I've got a customer that is rude, that is obnoxious, that it's, it just doesn't work, you know?
Right.
You need to be polite. You need to be, you know, and then just talk to me if you've got an issue. I will fix it. I will fix it. I promise. And my customers know that, and there will be no problems. I will fix it, because even if it costs me a little bit, it brings me way more pleasure to take care of the issue. Mm. So there's no reason to be rude or upset or really, you know what I mean? And it doesn't happen very often in the tea world, but it can. So I like to work with people that are into what they're doing and love their customers and just really have that passion to provide a great product.
So one of the things that I like to talk about, and so what happens is that a lot of people, especially when they're working with a large company, when small businesses that are working with large companies, right? Mm-hmm. They get this marquee syndrome is what I call it. It's, oh my gosh, if I get this marquee account, this, you know, big brand, and I can use the logo, which you can almost never use the logo, by the way. Usually big companies don't let small businesses out that relationship. So if you are lucky to have that you are fortunate, but most of the time that doesn't happen. But people are like, oh my gosh, if I just get this big account, then everything else will fall into place. But those big accounts, like I said, they're like super demanding. They're demanding. They will rip you to shreds on price because their procurement people are skilled at beating people down on price. So not only are you lowering your margin, your profit margin, but you're increasing your cost. So you're not only lowering your margin on top in terms of what you're selling at, but you're also increasing your cost because they're going to want faster delivery time. They're gonna want preferential treatment. They're gonna ask you to change how you do customer service. They may tell you to change how you're hiring people and the type of people that you can hire. I mean, it is astonishing to me that people kind of go into these big relationships without having clear understanding of what the impact of them is. And it's important, and people will say, well, why is knowing my customer important from a negotiation perspective, right? Everyone thinks, oh, you got to know that from a marketing perspective, but you also need to know it from a negotiation perspective, because it's where you find options. So for you, having that mistake, or not mistake, but that lesson early in your career, in your business, gave you information that allowed you to understand what your other options were. And was it going to take you longer? Yes, but as you said, you had time, and that's a really important factor. And so don't underestimate the importance of having clarity on who your customer is, because it drives how you negotiate on the back end, and it'll make a huge difference in terms of your overall profit margin.
Well, and I don't agree, and I don't think it's a good idea to take on a huge customer right away. I think you need to build, because in the case of what happened to me in 2013, I gave my all to this particular grocery store. I was doing demos. I was just, I mean, driving all over, talking. Oh my gosh. All my day was spent, and I didn't cultivate the other businesses. I was very focused on the growth, and I thought, this is the way to go. This is what I want to do. And so when I would meet with the manager, the one that was the buyer, he would make comments like all you vendors are like bugs or mosquitoes, or he was very condescending and very like, just really had that, what's that syndrome when you think you're a king or something?
Oh, I don't know. A narcissist? I don't know what it is.
Kind of put up with it for a while, but then I was thinking, well, this is not the way I want to, this is not the kind of people I want to be around all the time. Fortunately, the people in the stores were very nice. So, but what I learned when that relationship was kind of separated was, and that was 2013 and 14, I flatlined. So fortunately, it wasn't all my business. It was a big part of my business. It caused me not to grow for 1 year, but I took that whole year and developed, you know, what kind of customers do I want? Who do I want to work with long-term? You know, so I would, I went from that way. And then within a year, it was like I never lost that business. It was just, you know, from there, it just grew. And then every day after that, I look at my numbers. I look at all my customers. I say, okay, who's dominating me right now? Where do I need to correct that and make sure? And it just really actually helps you grow more. Because if you come from the set mindset is, we're doing a lot of business over here, so I need to pick some business up over here. Whole business grow, you know? And that's kind of the biparticle or bipart or whatever.
Byproduct.
Yeah. Of that, because I think in a certain way, but it's not like I'm losing this stuff. I'm just growing more of this type of business. Mm.
Well, that, I like that, because I mean, for publicly traded companies, they have to disclose in their financial statements if a customer represents a huge percentage of their revenue, right? Mm-hmm. Because that introduces risk.
Yes.
And so when you have a big marquee account, and you're suffering from marquee syndrome, right? That when you put all your eggs in one or two baskets or even three, and 80, 90% of your revenue is coming from them, then you've introduced a ton of risk into your business that becomes very difficult to manage, because especially as a small business owner, because you don't have a lot of control and influence over that large entity. And they're always looking for ways to replace you. And no matter how great your relationship is with a big company, they're always looking. They're always talking to your competition. They're always trying to get better prices. Can they get the product faster? Can they get it, you know, whatever it is that they're trying to do. And if you think otherwise, I would challenge you to ask questions in a different way to test whether your assumption is true or whether what Brenda and I are talking about is actually true in your market, because I'd say 95% of the time, what Brenda and I are describing is the way that it plays out. And, you know, and that puts you at risk long-term for your, and maybe even short-term in your own business.
So I'll give you a great example of, because of COVID last year, because of course I'm very food service dominant. And so I have three major customers that are different. They're two of them are franchises and one is a distributor, a coffee distributor. And so all of them were kind of neck and neck last year, but because of COVID, one of them, really dropped down significantly because they lost a bunch of their business. So it was the coffee distributor. So he was distributing to a bunch of restaurants a lot. They would distribute their coffee and our tea, as our brand together like that. And they would sell to the store, to the restaurants. Well, a lot of the restaurants closed. Right. And so they could no longer sell. And then they're trying to correct right now and get new business. But I saw a significant, like, I don't know, 50% drop but the other two, which pushed the other two up a little higher and then them lower. Mm-hmm. And so I noticed that had I only had them, you know, then the other and not the other two, I could have been in much bigger trouble last year than I was. Mm-hmm. So my numbers went down a little bit, but not like they could have because the other two companies were holding their own.
Right.
So that's another reason just not to, because you never know when you're going to have a pandemic. You know, it's just
right. Yeah, exactly. Like, right. Like last year, we spent a lot of time restructuring leases mm-hmm. for restaurants and retail stores and negotiating with their landlords. And you just never know. And it was really interesting to see in the real estate space who survived and who didn't and how real estate companies dealt with them. And so, you know, that it affects every business, right? And, you know, and if you have just these one or two marquee accounts and you're kind of held hostage to them and their business suffers,
exactly.
then what do you do? And it becomes this chain reaction, which we're seeing. We're seeing it throughout the supply chain, right? Where there is this chain reaction. And I've talked before on the show, and last fall, I was attended at an event. I was actually a co-host for the event. And we talked about the supply chain, and we talked about the issues related to COVID plus tariffs and what that meant. Product was sitting, you know, in, you know, the harbor in Los Angeles and, you know, just sitting on ships. I mean, they started charging storage fees in the shipping industry because big tanker, big ships were, you know, were just sitting in the harbor for weeks at a time. And then, you know, the Port of Los Angeles had its busiest year on record last year. But what happened, and this is very much a negotiation component, is that stuff product came in and big companies got it. And so smaller companies were left kind of going, where's my product? But because of their contracts, the larger organizations got it first. And so, you know, if you, whether it's in the supply chain or whether it's your customer base, having, you know, that diversity in your supplier base and in your customers makes a difference, and that impacts your ability to negotiate going forward. So Brenda, this has been amazing. I've really enjoyed this conversation. How can people find you? And I think you said you had something for our listeners too.
Well, so we offer, I have a little tip, like the three tips to a perfect cup of tea. Mm. And just some best practices when you're making tea, just three things. It's basically tea, time, and temperature. And so it's just a little report and you can get it. It's on our website. If you go onto our website, sterlingtea.com, it'll be a little box that pops up that you can subscribe and then get this little download. Okay. Or you can go to sterlingtea.com/tea tips. So either way, you can come to our site and we have a lot of different tea blends in all the categories, black, green, white, oolong, hibiscus, rooibos, some herbals like you are enjoying. You like the lemongrass. We got a lot of that. So, if you visit sterlingtea.com, you can get that little report and maybe enjoy some tea. So
awesome.
On there, I guess there's a 10% off discount coupon out there too. So,
Sweet. Well, thank you very much. And I really appreciate that. And I hope the audience will definitely go to the website. We'll put everything in the show notes so you'll be able to see that. And just thank you so much. And
you're so welcome.
I really, really appreciate it. And I am enjoying my sterling tea right now. And thank you very much. And everybody who's listening, we really appreciate you tuning in for all of our episodes. Can't wait to see you next time. Until then, just remember that negotiation is nothing more than a conversation about a relationship, and you cannot win our relationship. Thanks very much, everyone, and we'll see you next time. Have a great day.
Thank you for joining us for this episode of In the Venn Zone with Christine McKay. We invite you to visit our website at www.venn.zone to access the show notes and other helpful resources. Empower the negotiator in you and successfully level the playing field. Join us again next time here on In the Venn Zone.